they are caring more about punching holes in the darkness than they are them. My life is his. I have committed my life to him to use me any way he pleases in order to make his name great. That's suffering for Jesus. And he's saying that is what is the norm in this kingdom of God. What is it that makes you cry or happy or sad or miserable? What is it that every single one of these men were discouraged in their life, that they did something that I want?
All right, good morning. Good morning to those of you that are here in Phoenix. We are so glad you are here. And if you are new, we're glad you're joining us today. For those of you that are watching us online, apps, Roku, YouTube, any way you found us, we are glad you are joining us today. Also, if you want to know more about our ministry, you can go online to womensbiblestudy.com. There you can get handouts, you can watch lessons, past lessons, guest speakers. Everything you want to know about us is on there. Now, for those of you that are here, just remember, in front of you, you have little donation boxes. Please, please, please put money in there, only because it costs us a fortune to do what we do here. And then for those of you that watch us online, we ask if you would go online and donate $5 a month. That pays for us bringing this Bible study to you. So how's that? All right, we are in a series in the life of David called This is Life. And the whole idea is that life is filled with good days and bad days. And some days you feel like you're at the beach and everything is great and your marriage is good and your health is good and everything is wonderful. And then you find out some days that you feel like you're in a desert and everything is dry and cracked and the marriage isn't that good and your health isn't that great and life just doesn't seem to be working very well for you. So that's what the series is about. We're talking about King David because we've seen him live both of these beach and desert lives. Now, we know that last Tuesday night, probably your Wednesday morning, there was somebody like Mr. Donald Trump that felt like he was in the beach and Miss Hillary Clinton was in a desert, okay? So that's how that played. That is just clearly life. And I want to talk to you for a second, really quick, for those of you who are completely distraught over this this election, because believe it or not, I've heard from a lot of people, a lot of Christians. And so I just want to remind you that God is the one who raises and deposes kings. And for such a time as this, he has raised up Donald Trump to be our president, and we have to embrace that and be excited about it and pray for him and pray for our country. I thought it was so amazing. I don't know if a lot of you saw the 60-minute interview on Sunday night, but it amazed me how he really, honestly, I don't think really thought he was going to win. Like, it kind of came out in that he was more shocked at that. And it just reminded me that what we talked about a few weeks ago with the Jebusites when David went in to take over Jerusalem, because the Jerusalem as it is today, and it was a walled city and it was fortified for 400 years. And it was one of those things, like, they laughed at David and said, he'll never be able to break down the walls and come in here. And he did, because that's where God wanted him. And so I look at this election as God being so behind it. And it's so hard. I just talked to Juan, the guy who helped set up, and he's Spanish, and being in Arizona, this has been a very hard election for him. He told me ahead of time he was voting for Clinton because he has a lot of friends that are dealing with the whole immigration problem. We're on the other side of that where we have a business and taxes would, so there's just all of these, there's so many people that have such strong feelings about it, but I just want us to go back and remember that God is in control of this election. And he's raising up Mr. Trump for the reason that he has. So we'll go with that. How's that? I actually found myself very sad for Hillary on Wednesday morning. And I was shocked. I woke up and that was my first thought over there. And I think it was because all of her life, she has put her whole life into politics and her identity is in politics. And now in one fell swoop, everything's gone out of her life in that aspect. And so it made me really, really sad. It was cute. One of the girls that comes, her name's Angela. She has about a four-year-old son. He comes running down the stairs that morning, and he said, "Did Mr. Trump win?" She calls him Trump. "Did Mr. Trump win?" And she said, "Yeah, baby, he did." And he immediately looked at her and said, "Was the lady sad? Do you think she'll be okay?" I know, sweetest thing ever. But here's the deal. When you and I have our identity in Jesus, it doesn't matter whether you're at the beach, and it doesn't matter if you're in a desert. It doesn't matter if you're Donald Trump or if you were Hillary Clinton last week. If you were a follower of Jesus, you know God controls everything and he controls your life and he's moving you in different directions. And that's what made me sad for her. I think she doesn't get that. And I think her whole world is probably falling apart right now. So I think we need to pray for both of them. All right. In China. Last week we were in China. Thank you for not showing up here. My nickname, you're going to be shocked at this. Princess. That's what they called me. That's what the team called me. I couldn't even understand. I'm like, why would you call me that? Here's why. I think I was the pickiest eater of the group. They're like, here, would you like some duck? And I'm like, ooh, who eats that? Would you like some vegetables? No. Would you like some fish? Okay, so this went on the whole trip. And so if you're wondering, like, people say, man cannot live on bread alone. Let me tell you what man can live on. Rice, bread, and peanut M&Ms. Okay, we took our stash over of peanut M&Ms because I thought that's what I would be eating. We ran out. China has peanut M&Ms. They do not taste the same. Yep, it's really weird, I know. All right, for all the brains that are in China, here's my takeaway. Who eats with these? Okay, doesn't this just make more sense? Okay, so here's my illustration. I thought about this morning. I decided someone needs to come up with this. This is our new diet, okay? Anyone come up with it, write a book, I don't care. I won't even take credit for it. This is why I think they're all skinny in China. Because, see here, I got this. These are all, you can't see it, these are all M&Ms. Now, here's my new diet. You can't eat anything unless you eat it with this. You can't pick up an M&M with these stupid things. So if you can't pick it up, you can't eat it. See? I think that's what we should do. This is why I like spoons right here. See? You put it on there and you can just take spoonfuls of it. So that's my new chopsticks diet. So someone can come up with it. The hotel we were at, they had some forks. And so one day there was one fork left. And everyone on our team around the table, they're like, only one fork. They took a vote on who was the neediest person in the group. They said that was Lisa. So I got the fork. Yay. All right. The other problem in China is bathrooms. They do not have, well, they did in our hotel, but anywhere you go, they don't have Western toilets. They're called squatty potties. You have to stand up. They have a place for your feet. And somehow you do this and don't get it all over your clothes. And I have no idea. I never did it. It was my goal to hold it until I got back to the hotel every night. But I still couldn't figure it out. I'm like, you can't read in the bathroom when you're doing it. Like you just go in and get out, I guess. It's the weirdest thing. All right, here's what else I learned. Pollution. I have never seen such pollution in all my life. So people wore these things. Okay. So I decided I can't wear these because it would ruin my outfit. Someone would have to come up with some kind of designer colored thing. It like ruins the makeup, it ruins the outfit. So yeah, it was good to get home, all right? All right, but here's why we teach Bible. So this is why. Because when Rob and I got there, they said, go to the teller and get money. So we went to the teller, and they're called RMB, like 100 RMB. It's like a $100 bill, but it really is like $15. So we go there, and he gets money out, and then we ended up someplace where we need to get a taxi. So we got a taxi, and he gets us in the car, in the taxi, and then he pulls us to a side street. And he starts talking to us in Chinese. We have no idea what he's saying. He wants money. So Rob pulls out 100 RMB, and the guy freaks out on him. And he's like screaming at him and yelling. We have no idea what's going on. We can't speak Chinese. And so this went on, so Rob pulled another one out, thinking, well, nope, screamed and yelled at him. So finally, we had to get out of the taxi. We had to walk back to the street, find a new taxi. When we got back to the hotel, Rob tried to pay him again. Same thing. He was screaming at us. We're like, what in the world is going on? So by this time, Rob needs a glass of wine. So we go upstairs, and Rob orders a glass of wine and tries to pay with the same money that he just tried to pay. And she said, no, 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 it's bad money. It's bad money. So the teller machine gave us counterfeit money. Yep. And we had no idea. So no, we're like, no wonder that guy was freaking out on us. But here's what I learned. These people can spot a counterfeit from a mile away. Like the minute we handed it to them, it was how it felt. It was how it looked. Like they just knew immediately. And I was sitting there thinking, that is why we teach Bible right there. Because I want us to know the Word of God so well that if any other counterfeit, you know, religion or someone comes knocking at your door saying, hey, I need you to, you know, believe this new gospel or whatever, you can say, no, I have the real thing. So I did learn that. I'm amazed at how the Holy Spirit is working in China. Like, seriously, I think that was my one takeaway. I felt like they didn't so much need us there. I learned so much from them. They don't have big churches like we have. They really do have to, it's called the underground church. You have to meet in small little apartments with people. You can have maybe 15 people there, maybe 20. They serve a meal afterwards. They worship, they pray. It was the coolest experience ever. And I thought about it afterwards, and I thought, I think maybe that is what we could be missing here. Because, you know, we go to, and I'm not down on the big churches, we all go to them, but it just, I think that was the one takeaway for me, was that it was such a small knit community, and then they would invite their friends and their friends would come in. It was really, really cool. One pastor, we met him, he has been a pastor, he's been a Christian for 8 years and he's a pastor. And I said, how did you become a Christian? And he said, I had never ever heard the word Jesus before, never. And he said, I was listening on my radio one day, and all of a sudden, someone comes on the radio and starts talking about Jesus. I'd never heard of him. The more I listened, he said, I gave my life to him, and he becomes a Christian, and he is a pastor, and goes through. Like, just stories like that over and over and over again about how God is just on the move in China. So I was really excited. One of the last days, we went to a seminary with some college kids who were, they were there to study the Word of God for hours and hours and hours a day so that they could go out and become missionaries in the world. It was probably the most moving day of our life because they just sat there. We said, where do you want to be missionaries at? And they would say, I want to go to Saudi Arabia. I want to go to Russia. They were naming all these countries, and their heart was just so filled with just, they just know that that's what they're supposed to be doing in this world. So I really honestly feel like I learned so much more from them than anything we could have taught them. So all in all, it was a good trip. Thankfully for spoons and forks and no pollution here. So that works out really good for me. So, all right, let's talk about David. Well, let's get a little recap for those of you that are new here. David, we are in the middle of the series. David has, when he was a teenager, he was anointed to be king, and about 22 years later, he actually became king of all Israel. It took a long time. He went through a lot of deserts. He went through a lot of beaches, so we get that. God chose David because David was a man after God's own heart, and so that's what we've been looking at this whole time. What does that look like? And we've actually been shocked to see that a man after God's own heart acts like David acts, because he does things that you and I don't think would ever do. But this is what we're learning about David. He kind of is a lot like us. He has moments in his life, maybe months, years. We hear from people all the time that say, Lisa, I used to go to church and I used to read my Bible, and then I quit for 5 years, and now I found your Bible study and I'm just now coming back. And we hear the same thing over and over, and that's what we've seen through David. It's kind of like, yay, I love Jesus and I'm going to church and I'm reading my Bible and everything's great. And then we've seen him just walk away from God for years. And so it's just this whole up and down life, and we're seeing that. But we see David where he has this complete trust in God, like the whole David and Goliath with the stones. And then 2 months later, you see him running from Saul, drooling down his beard and acting like a crazy man because he's terrified. So we see a lot in David of you and I, that we can be the same way as that. And so where we are today is there's two stories in the Bible that most people know, even if they've never been to church. You've heard about David and Goliath, and most everybody here has heard about David and Bathsheba. So for those of you that think that the Bible is really, really boring, I'm hoping that today we'll quell that thought, okay? Because today we're going to talk about something that could be on the news tonight on CNN or Fox. It's political, it's adultery, it's scandal, it's murder, like all of these things could be on the news. And this was like 4,000 years ago, okay? So nothing really has changed, I guess. So I want to talk about this whole idea that when God tells you and I not to do something in life, he has a really good reason for it.
It's not because he hates you. It's not because he's just a killjoy. He really, really honestly is trying to protect you from bad things that are going to happen. And so today I want to start off and explain to you that I don't care how good of a Christian you are, that when you have someone like David who is called a man after God's own heart, and he falls into the deepest sin that most of us will never ever fall into, I want us to understand how easy it can be for any one of us for that to happen. So we're going to work through and we're going to talk about this downward spiral of how David went from here to here. And today what happens, his life has changed forever. Nothing in his life will ever be the same because of his one thing he did. And it starts with this. 2 Samuel 11, verse 1. In the spring, when kings go to battle. Here's the deal. They never fought in the wintertime. I guess it was probably too rainy. It was too snowy. It was too muddy. I don't really know. They never fought in the winter. They only came out in spring. So now it's springtime. And guess what? If you are the king, it's your job to go to battle with your people. But look what he says next. David sent Joab with his servants and all Israel, and they ravaged the Ammonites' country and besieged Rabbah. But David remained in Jerusalem. Now, nobody knows why. Why would he do that? Now, maybe he was tired. By this time, he's 50 or 60 years old. I get that. I said, told someone today, I'm 50-ish, okay? I have to actually count back if I want to know what the ish is. So, but here's the deal. Maybe he was tired. I think I told you my little story that I work in with two-year-olds at church in the first hour, which is so funny. Shine was telling someone the other day, they said, she was talking to someone and they were talking about how, oh, your mom has so many kids and grandkids, she must just love kids. And she goes, no, my mom hates kids. And I'm like, oh, and she goes, that I had to go back and say, well, she didn't really hate them. Like, she just, you know. But so we work with two-year-olds. Okay, get that. Cheyenne and I do that. But one kid wouldn't stop crying, so I was holding him. And then I think I told you, I sat down on the floor while I was holding him, and then I got back up while I was holding him. Next day, pretty much thought I was going to die. Every muscle in my legs were completely pulled out. I could hardly walk, and I'm thinking, what did I do yesterday? I sat down and got up, okay, with about 20 pounds in my arm, 30 pounds. Okay, so it was a bad deal. But so if someone said, hey, Lisa, at your age, do you want to go out to battle? And do you want to go run and climb mountains and shoot arrows and run from people? I'd be like, no, thanks. Staying in the palace, okay, because I'm a princess. See, I can say that now. Maybe the other thing is maybe he felt like he was just too important. Like if I go at the on the battle and I get killed, who's going to run the country? Maybe that was a fear for him. Or maybe he looked out his window and he saw right below his palace a beautiful woman. So really it could have been anything, but here's what we do know, and this is the first step to your spiral. David was somewhere where he should not have been. And when you get to that point where you know you're someplace, you're on your computer where you shouldn't be, you're at that bar where you shouldn't be, you're at that place where you shouldn't be, that's the beginning, and always remember that, of this spiral down. Verse 2, one evening, David arose from his couch, was walking on the roof of the king's house when from there he saw a woman bathing, and she was very lovely to behold. Now you have a picture in your handout of, that actually is a picture of Israel. So I want you to think if we're standing in the palace, that is what David would have seen below him. And so you see these flat rooftops. Now the weird thing is I've always been taught that Bathsheba was taking a bath on the rooftop. The Bible does not say that. It says David was up on his rooftop. It doesn't tell us where Bathsheba was. Like she could have been in her house bathing. David could have binoculars. Okay, he could have one of those telescopes. We don't know. Okay, if you look at your picture, there's this whole outcropping of like trees. Maybe her bathtub was under the tree. Like it doesn't really say that she was out there, just bathing in front of him. Now, for her, we realized later that she was bathing because the law said that when you're a woman and you're on your period, you're considered unclean for 7 days while you're on your period, and then 7 days after. So we know from later verses it says that she was bathing to basically purify herself. But the question is, it's an age-old question you'll have to ask God when you get to heaven. Did she know that David was up there watching? I don't know. I mean, she knows the palace is right behind her. I'm assuming she knows her neighbors. Assuming she's looked up and seen King David roaming around. And so the question is, was she down there where she could, like, be naked and entice him?
Or maybe not. Because here's my thinking. Bathsheba's husband just went off to war. She knew all the men went off to war. She would most likely assume David would be off to war. So if she was bathing, she probably never expected him to be up there in the palace. I think I told you my Africa trip before. I went to Africa once, and they put us in these tents, and they zip them up, and it was dark and terrifying. It was one of those things. But anyway, they showed us our bed, and then they walked outside, and there was a bathtub outside. And they're like, here's your bathtub. And I'm like, Rabbi, I'm not taking a bath outside, okay? A black mamba snake could come get in the bathtub with me. A lion could come around the corner and jump in the bathtub and eat me. I'm not doing that. But creepier than that was like, who's around watching? You know, so I find it hard to believe that Bathsheba is going to be upstanding or, bathing on top of a roof where someone can see her. I find that hard to believe unless she really was trying to seduce the king. And those are things that we just really won't ever know. I thought this was cute. It's a true story of a banquet where a famous pastor ended up sitting next to a woman who was kind of had like really large breasts. Okay. She had a really low cut dress on, so they were kind of hanging out. And so instead of becoming embarrassed or angry or pretending like he didn't see it, he just looked at her, grabbed an apple and handed it to her, and she was confused and he said, No, please, madam, take the apple. Because it was only after Eve ate the apple that she became aware of how little she had on. I thought that was cute. Oh, my gosh. Okay. First step to your downward spiral is when you come upon something that you know that you shouldn't be seeing or doing, you better turn around and run and stop looking. The second step, if you don't turn around and run, the next step you're going to enter is called the inquiring stage. Look at verse 3. David sent and inquired about the woman. Now for you, it may be, hey, where did you say that bar was again? Hey, what channel did you say that was on again? What was your phone number again? Hey, could I Facebook message you? Like, there's all different ways we can just start inquiring. And when you move into that inquiry stage, you have just moved into a place where you should not be. David had great, great men around him. And so when he inquired, look what they said to him. One said, is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam and the wife of Uriah the Hittite? In other words, David, here's the problem. Yeah, she's hot. Okay, she has a husband, she's a father. We find out later that her grandfather was someone who turns away from David at the end, and probably because he's so angry with what David did to his family. And they're trying to say, David, before you go all stupid man on us, you better think about this. But David refused to think about it. Look at verse 4. And David sent messengers and took her, and she came into him and lay with him, for she was purified from her uncleanness. Then she returned to her house. And here's the question, why didn't, when they come to her, say, King David would like to see you, why didn't she say, no, I would never do that, I'm a married woman. And I don't know the culture back then, and maybe you don't say no to the king. But I know earlier in the Bible when you see Joseph with Potiphar's wife, he said no, he went to prison for it, but it was okay because he kept his integrity. Bathsheba could have kept her integrity, and so could have David, but neither one of them did. Now, here's what we do know is for David, David knew not only was this a really bad idea, but it was disobedience to the commands of God. He knew Exodus 20:14 says, you shall not commit adultery. David knew what he was doing. And what amazes me about David is how could he do this? Like, we have seen him over and over with Saul. When they said, kill King Saul, you have this perfect opportunity. Every time his integrity rose to the top and he said, I could never do that to God. I just can't. I love God too much. And so I don't understand what just happened here. And people say, well, he was just in the wrong place at the wrong time. No. If you were at the 85th floor of the Twin Towers on 9/11, you are at the wrong place at the wrong time. If you are up on top of your palace staring at a naked woman and inviting her to sleep with you, that is blatant sin and blatant choice. Proverbs 22:3 says this, a prudent and far-sighted person sees the evil of sin and hides himself from it. See, we have to look out in front of us and say, whoa, 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 I see that might be a problem, and you run and hide from it. But the naive continue on and are punished by suffering the consequences. See, to me, this is a huge lesson for us, that when temptation is right in front of us, we have to run. And you say, but Lisa, you don't understand. I cannot run from the temptation that's in front of me. I say, yes, you can, and this is why. 1 Corinthians 10:13 says, no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he also will provide a way out so you can endure it. It's a promise that he will give you a way out. I learned this with my peanut M&Ms. I had a big bag in my freezer, okay? And I kept saying, this is ridiculous. I am never going to be on a diet and lose weight if I have it in there, because I walk by, grab a handful, walk by again, grab another hand. This goes on all day long. And so one day I said, all right, if I want to get rid of the temptation, I need to get rid of the bag of M&Ms. So I threw them away. Well, actually, that's not true. Okay, I ate them first, and then I threw the bag away, okay? I said, if I have to be without them, then that's sad for me. So that's my new thing. Although I came home from China, and I opened my freezer, there was a little bag of peanut M&Ms in there. I got them from a movie, I guess, and stuck them in there. I ate them last night. I'm sorry. I felt I had to confess that. But here's the deal. That's how it is with you. If you have a problem with alcohol, with the bottle of Jack Daniels, then you know what? See, when you get to the store, walk past the aisle, and if you're like, I can't, then send somebody else grocery shopping for you, okay? If you don't have any money and you're a clothes-aholic and you're trying to, like, shop and you don't have any money, you know what? Pass by the mall. Just don't go in. You know there's too much temptation there. If that guy that you really know you shouldn't be with, you kind of have his number and you're thinking, I should just call him. Don't. Delete his phone number, delete his Facebook, delete his Twitter, delete his Snapchat, delete whatever it is you kids do nowadays, okay? But there is always a way out. That's a promise from God. We just have to take it. Now, here's the point that I want you to get. If in fact you are here and you say, I'm a follower of Jesus, and you know what the Bible says and you do it anyway, I want you to know that there will always, always, always be consequences. That is another promise from God. Here's David's beginning of his downward spiral. Verse 5, and the woman became pregnant and sent and told David, I am with child. Now you wonder how many months it's been. And I kept thinking, I was laughing, I was thinking, you wonder how awkward this was. Okay, she's right below him, he's up in the palace. You wonder if, like, he'd walk on the palace and she'd be like, hey David, he'd be like, hey Beth, how's it going, babe? Like, did they see each other? Did they sleep with each other? Like, we have no idea. Like, this could have been going on for months. Did they just sleep together once? However it happened, she went to Walgreens, got a pregnancy test, and said, woohoo, I am with child, all right? Not a good idea, since her husband was off to battle. So when David finds this out, he decides, all right, I've got this brilliant plan, little Beth, this is what we're going to do. So here's his plan. He decides to bring Uriah back, but it all starts with lying. One lie leads to another lie and more lies, and it's just deceit on top of deceit. I thought this was cute. A youth pastor called his pastor one time and said, I won't be there at church today, at Sunday. He says, I have the flu. Well, someone came up afterwards and said, hey, I just saw so-and-so. He was on his way to the Cardinals game. And the pastor was really upset. So that afternoon after church service, he called the youth pastor. And he said, someone saw you going to the Cardinals game. And the youth pastor said, that is a vicious lie. And he said, and I will send you the picture of my fish to show you. He went fishing. Okay, you know it's a bad joke when you have to explain it. All right, verse 6. So this is David's plan. David sent to Joab, his general, and said, send me Uriah the Hittite, which is Bathsheba's husband. So Joab sent him Uriah. When Uriah had come to him, David asked him how Joab was. Like, look at David. Isn't this pathetic? Like, he's just making up all these things. How's my general doing? How are the people faring? How is the war progressing? And David said to Uriah, go down to your house, wash your feet. Uriah went out of the king's house, and there followed him a mess of food, a gift from the king. In other words, David was saying, go have sex with your wife. Here's some food. Have a romantic dinner. It's all going to be awesome. Just go for it, Uriah. That's not what happened. Because Uriah was a very, very honorable man. He loved his king. He loved his country. He loved his God. Look what he says. But Uriah slept at the door of the king's house with all the servants of his lord and did not go down to his house. When they told David Uriah did not go down to his house, David said to Uriah, have you not come home from a journey? Why did you not go down to your house? Which is code for, what's the problem with you? You have a hot wife. Why are you not having sex with her? I'm giving you every opportunity to do this. Uriah said to David, the ark and Israel and Judah live in tents. And my lord Joab and the servants of my lord are camping in the open field. Shall I then go to my house to eat and drink and lie with my wife as you live and my soul lives? I will not do such a thing. Ooh, David's in serious trouble now. We went to our granddaughter's volleyball game at Liberty High School. When Cheyenne went to Liberty, they left on this wall, this big mural thing. And it was a saying, and I looked up at it, and it reminded me of this, and this is what it said. Ability may get you to the top, but it takes character to stay there. And David, God had given David so much ability to be king and to rule the way God called him to rule, and yet what we see is David's character has just gone right down the drain. And from here on out, David's world spirals down, and it will, like I said, never be the same as we'll see today and next week. When the guy working for him has more character than he does, that's a problem. So David comes up with plan B. Verse 12, and David said to Uriah, remain here today also, and tomorrow I will let you depart. So Uriah remained in Jerusalem that day and the next, and David invited him, and he ate with him and drank so that he made him drunk. But that night he went out to lie on his bed with the servants of his lord and did not go down to his house. Even him getting him drunk, no matter what David did, Uriah refused to sleep with his wife. The coolest part about that is that not only did no one know, everyone saw that he was sleeping with the servants by David. Like, everyone knew, like, he never went to his wife. So there was not even any cover-up that could happen, like, oh, he snuck off and had sex with her really quick. It wasn't like that. Everyone knew he did not sleep with his wife. That's a problem for David. And here is what our super awesome man after God's own heart does. Verse 14. In the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it with Uriah. And he wrote in the letter, put Uriah in the front line of the heaviest fighting and withdraw from him that he may be struck down and die. Could you even imagine that he has gone to this length to cover up his own sin? He is going to kill his lover's husband on the battlefield? Like, it's unimaginable to me. Verse 16, so when Joab was besieging the city, he assigned Uriah opposite where he knew the enemy's most valiant men were. The men of the city came out and fought with Joab, and some of the servants of David fell. Uriah the Hittite died also. Then Joab sent and told David all things concerning the war. The messenger said to David, surely the men prevailed against us and came out to us to the field, but we were upon them even to the entrance of the gate. Then the archers shot at your servants from the wall. Some of the king's servants are dead, and your servant Uriah the Hittite is dead also. When Uriah's wife heard that her husband was dead, she mourned for Uriah. And when the mourning was past, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. And he lived happily ever after. The end. Let's pray. Okay. Yeah, let me tell you. Look what the next verse says. But the thing that David had done was evil in the sight of the Lord. See, you may be here or watching us and think you're getting away with a whole lot of stuff, but I want to tell you right now, you will never, ever get away with it if you are a follower of Jesus. It's not going to happen. And so I want you to remember this, that God sees exactly what is going on in your life. And what happened for David is that it was told to him, the Lord said it was evil in his sight. So God sends a really awesome person into David's life. His name is Nathan. Nathan is a prophet. He's a trusted advisor. He's a very good friend of David. And so he comes to David and he starts telling him the story. 2 Samuel 12, verse 1. So the Lord sent Nathan to David. He came and said to him, there were two men in a city, one rich and the other poor.
The rich man had very many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing but one little ewe lamb, which he had brought up, bought and brought up, and it grew up with him and his children. It ate of his own morsel, drank from his own cup, lay in his bosom, and was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, and to avoid taking one of his own flock or herd to prepare for the wayfaring man who had come to him, he took the poor man's lamb, prepared it for his guest. And David heard this story and was absolutely furious. How in the world could somebody do this? How awful that this rich man would take this poor man's little lamb. Something has to be done about it. And Nathan, look at verse 5. Then David's anger was greatly kindled against this man. And he said to Nathan, "As the Lord lives, the man who has done this is a son worthy of death. He shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and had no pity." And you can just imagine Nathan just sitting there going, It's like David could not understand why someone would take something that wasn't theirs and yet keep it for their own benefit. And as he stared at David, Nathan looked at him in verse 7 and said, "You are the man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel." And he tells him, this is what God says to you, David. God says, "I anointed you king of Israel. I delivered you out of the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your bosom and gave you the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, David, I would have added that much again." He's saying, "David, I would have done anything for you. What is your problem? Why would you go after the one thing that I didn't give you? It makes no sense to me." Verse 9, "Why have you despised the commandment of the Lord, doing evil in his sight? You have slain Uriah the Hittite with the sword and have taken his wife to be your wife. You have murdered him with the sword of the Ammonites." Always, always remember that God sees exactly what is going on in our lives. We have seen over the last year a whole lot of lies on the TV from a lot of politicians, okay? That's just the nature of it. But I was thinking about this with all the people that lied, all the politicians that lied over the years. You had Richard Nixon who said, "I am not a crook," okay? You have, it must have been one of the Bushes that said, "I will not raise taxes." We have Miss Hillary that just says, "I didn't know it was wrong to have a server and to delete 30,000 emails." Okay, so all of this whole time, we have lies, and the list goes on and on and on of every person, politician, that has said something that was a lie. And here's what we realize, that the politicians can fool us, and they can fool the whole public, the people that are voting for them, but they cannot ever fool God. He sees exactly what's going on. And whether it's the White House or it's your house, God knows what is happening. Now, Nathan is a great friend, and I want to just say this. If you have a friend that you know is in trouble, that is doing something stupid, you need to go and sit down and talk to them. Here's why. I thought about this the other day. Here's a piece of lettuce. If you and I were going out to lunch, and I had a salad, which would never happen, but okay. Here you go. What if I had it in my teeth like this? And I was carrying on this whole conversation with you? What if you never told me? Okay? How good of a friend would you be? I would never go to lunch with you again. If I had lettuce hanging out of my mouth and you never told me, serious, okay? But here's the thing, is that you know if I walked out of there with lettuce hanging out of my mouth that I would be so embarrassed. And see, for David or Nathan, he knows that what David has done is going to embarrass him. And moreover than that, it will embarrass his God. That is what we forget. We wander around and we say, "But I'm a Christian." And then you go get drunk on the weekend and everyone sees you drunk and throwing up all over the place. And you say, "But I'm a Christian." And then you start gossiping or you start lying or you start stealing and people are looking at you like, "What is this whole I believe in God and I'm a follower of Jesus thing?" Your life doesn't prove it at all. And I think that's what people had to have thought about David. He had maids and servants and cooks, and did you not think that they don't talk? Like, we think of like the National Enquirer, think of the Jerusalem Enquirer, okay? I mean, we're talking, this story is headline news. David's having an affair. I mean, you can just picture everything. You know, all of the people that have seen David is a man who's loved God all of these years. They've seen him bring the ark back, worship him, praise him, dance in the streets because he loves God so much. And now, look what happens to the reputation of God because of this. Can I just tell you, our behavior seriously affects how other people are going to feel about Jesus. Here's the consequences. Verse 10, now therefore, God tells him because of what he did, the sword will never depart from your house because you have not only despised my command, but you have despised me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. In other words, David's life is such a mess anyway. God told him, you don't take more than one wife. And he took more than one wife. He disobeyed God. You don't commit adultery. David committed adultery. You don't commit murder. David committed murder. And he's saying, David, because you did not listen to me, I'm going to tell you this right now. Your house will be in turmoil forever. For those of you that watch Sister Wives, I want you to take Sister Wives and times it by a million. Okay, this is going to be David's new hell that he's going to be living in. And the question is that you want to ask David at this point was, David, was that look into to Bathsheba's bathtub really worth it? Was that inquiry into who she was really worth it? Because my thinking is, David, I hope she was really good in bed, okay? Because if she wasn't, I'm sad for you because your whole life is going to be a mess from here on out. If we claim to be followers of Jesus, we have to act like it. I can't tell you how much it just destroys the people around us and what they think about God. But God is not done with David yet. Verse 11, thus says the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against you out of your own house. We're going to see that in a couple weeks, and it is horrifying what his son does, and it's all because of this. And I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this son. For you did it secretly, David, but I will do this thing before all of Israel and before all of men. At this point, David has to feel horrific. And David has a choice, just like you and I have a choice, when we are caught in our sin. Now, we could do, or David could have done, what one of our famous presidents did. Get on national news and say this. I did not have sexual relations with that woman, okay? That's what David could have done. When that particular former president was asked what he thought about foreign affairs, he said, I don't know, I've never had one. Sorry, okay. Don't leave and don't email me because there is a point to what I just said. And it'll come on the next joke, okay? But there is a point to why I say those things because you'll get that in a second. But David could have done that. He could have gotten in front of the news and said, that's not true. I didn't do that. I don't know whose baby that is. Like, I didn't kill. That just happened. Like, David could have done that. But David knows God well enough to know there's only one thing that is going to heal his relationship with God, and that is to confess his sin and repent. It was his job to confess and say, you know what, God, I am so sorry. I will never, ever do that again. I was wrong, totally wrong, and walk away from it from there on. Look what verse 13 says, and David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. See, we have to realize that when we sin, it might be against our husband or our friend or our child or whatever. Ultimately, when we sin, it is completely against the God of this heavens and earth. Nathan said to David, the Lord also has put away your sin. You shall not die. In other words, David, here's the deal. Okay, we got that. You've confessed it. You've repented. I'm not going to kill you on the spot. I was sort of laughing. We don't know what his other wives are going to do because they might want to kill him on the spot. But verse 14 says this, nevertheless, because by this deed you have utterly scorned the Lord and given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme. And that struck me so much because all I can do is think of all the people throughout this world that have done what David just did. And it caused people to turn away from God. All you have to do is say Jim Baker, Jimmy Swaggart. I could name a whole list of singers that have fallen, that had affairs with their whoever was on the road with them. Destroyed their relationship with God, destroyed their witness. That's just what happens. And God is saying, David, that's what you just did. He looks past our sin, and Jesus died on the cross for that, so please understand that. But here's what happens.
it hurts the reputation of God. I cannot look at Bill Clinton. I cannot read a story about Nixon. I cannot read stories about these people without thinking what they did. It destroys their reputation. Now, here's my other Bill Clinton joke. Kind of inappropriate. I'll just tell you that right off the bat. I wanted to tell it because I thought, I laughed hysterically, gave it to Rob, sent it to my mom and dad. We all laughed. My dad's like, are you telling that at Bible study? I'm like, kind of might be inappropriate. But it's not for today. So here you go. Bill Clinton and Dan Quayle and Newt Gingrich are all in the Rose Garden discussing, you know, policy. When all of a sudden a giant tornado comes and takes them up. And when it drops them back down, they realize that they're in Emerald City, the land of Oz. And so Dan Quayle says, oh, I'm so excited. I'm going to go see the wizard and I'm going to ask him for a brain. Newt Gingrich says, yes, I'm so excited. I'm going to go to the wizard and ask him for a heart. Bill Clinton says, where's Dorothy? I know. Okay. I laughed hysterically. Sorry. Okay, but here's my point to that whole thing. Three times today, I have said nothing but negative things about Bill Clinton. And never once did I say about anything about his policies, his foreign affairs, like whatever. Like the only thing I can come up with Bill Clinton when I see him is every sexual impropriety that he did. And he was the president of the United States, okay? I expect a little more out of our presidents. Like I expect his moral character and integrity in the White House, and there was none of that. And see, I think how sad it was that he disgraced the highest office in this land. That's why I tell jokes like that. But I know it's bad, but you'll get over it. Here's the deal. David did just the same thing. But the problem with Bill Clinton is I don't think he's ever really said, I know we've seen him at church, but I don't think he's ever come out and said, oh, I'm a follower of Jesus, and I'm going to, you never see that from him. David is a whole new ballgame. He did say that people knew he was a follower of God, and he not only destroyed his reputation, but he dishonored the name of God. Nathan comes along and says, forget that you have embarrassed yourself, David, but here's what I want you to know. You have destroyed the reputation of God to anyone that's an unbeliever that is seeking God. And that is the stakes that we are talking about when we do things against what God calls us to do. So God says, because of this fact, look at the next verse, the child that is born to you shall surely die. In other words, you and Bathsheba's little cute little adulterous affair that you didn't think was going to happen, that baby is going to die. You killed someone, David, you're going to find out what it feels like to have someone die that you love. Verse 15, then Nathan departed to his house, and the Lord struck the child that Uriah's widow bore to David, and he was very sick. David therefore besought God for the child, and David fasted and went in and lay all night repeatedly on the floor. Verse 19, but when David saw that his servants whispered, he perceived that the child was dead. So he said to them, is the child dead? And they said, he is. And David arose from the floor, washed, anointed himself, changed his apparel, and went into the house of the Lord and worshipped. Then he came to his own house, and when he asked, they set food before him, and he ate. And the servant said to him, what is it that you have done? You fasted and wept while the child was alive, but when the child was dead, you arose and ate food. And David said, while the child was still alive, I fasted and wept, for I said, who knows whether the Lord will be gracious to me and let the child live. But now he's dead, and why should I fast? Can I bring him back again? I shall go to him, but he will not return to me. Now some of you here know or have had children who died. You've had grandchildren that died. You know what that feels like. But I want to encourage you that this is the one place in the Bible that says when children die, they go to heaven. Because David made it very clear, he can't come back to me, but there will be a day when I will go to him. And I want for those of you, if you've never been here before, if you're watching us, however you found us, and you don't know that there is a heaven and that there is a hell, and that one of those two places are going to be your eternal destiny. The Bible says Jesus is the only way to get to heaven. And you need to give your life to him and give your heart to him and start living for him. Because this particular passage shows that there is a place that people go to when they die. And the Bible, the rest of it explains how that happens. As a follower of Jesus, your destination is also heaven. You cannot get there by your religion. Some of you people go to church all the time and you think, well, I just go to church, I'm good. Some of you think you're just good people. Doesn't work that way.
Your job is to put your faith and trust in Jesus alone for him to get you there. Now for David, I want you just to look at this whole downward spiral. He looks, he disobeys God, he stole another man's wife, he murdered him, he blatantly disregards the commands of God. And I want you to see that the commands in the Bible are there because what we see with David and all the consequences, God is seriously trying to protect you from that. But here's the great part about David. Even though he did all this, he knew in his heart that God had never abandoned him. And I want to talk to those of you for a second who have done things like David, probably not murder, or I always say you'd be in prison, but maybe you had the affair, or maybe you did whatever it was that you did that you just can't seem to get over. I want you to know that you have not been abandoned by God. You may suffer consequences. We'll see this in 2 weeks from now with the rest of the consequences that David had to live out. You may have a lot of consequences in your life. But if you have given your sin and repented and confessed to Jesus, they're gone. They're paid for. You can move on with your life. But like I said, you still probably will have consequences, but David knows God so well. He knows he's very gracious. He knows he's very forgiving. He knows that his job is to confess and own up to what he's done. And when we do that, here is Psalms 51. Look at this. David writes this. To the chief musician, a psalm of David when Nathan the prophet came to him after he had sinned with Bathsheba. Look what David said. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to the multitude of your tender mercy and loving kindness. Blot out my transgressions. I want you to think about everything you've ever done in your life that you just don't think God has forgiven you. And I want you to pretend there's a blotter with a black whatever it is, and you just blot it out as if it's not even there anymore, because that's what a promise that happens to you. Wash me thoroughly and repeatedly from my iniquity and guilt, and cleanse me and make me wholly pure. I want you to think of a fire hose that God is going on the inside of you, just fire hosing all the stuff and the yucky stuff that you're confessing. It's gone. It's washed away. 1 John 1:9 tells us more. If we confess our sins, that's all we have to confess it. He's faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from unrighteousness. And if you wonder where your sins go, look at Psalms 103:12. As far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed the transgressions from us. As far as the east is from the west, have you ever figured out where that is? Where does that stop? It doesn't. It's gone. That's why you need to confess and repent, because that is what frees you. It frees you from this bondage of guilt, this bondage of shame. You don't have that anymore when you do what David did. Confess and don't go back and do it again. And if you are here and you think, God could never forgive me, I want you to reread this story over and over and say, you know what? If God could forgive David for everything he did, killing an innocent man, sleeping with a married woman, he can forgive you. Please know that. That is how gracious God is. So this is how I want to end. When you get to that point where you're like, ah, that guy's hot. I think I want to have an affair. That money in the drawer at my office, the company doesn't really need it that bad. Like, you come up with your own scenario that's kind of a, you need to stop before you inquire. Because if you don't, you're going to partake. And I want to tell you three things. One, when you do that, you will ruin your reputation as a follower of Jesus. That is the most amazing reputation that you own. It will be destroyed. Two, there will always be consequences. Do not think it will not happen to me. Nope. That's a promise. Galatians talks about this whole sowing and reaping. Whatever you sow, you're going to reap. That's just the way it's going to be. So stop it ahead of time is what we're saying. And the third thing is, I want you always to know, you will destroy God's reputation. And people are not going to want to follow Jesus. And that is the hardest part for me. Here's what I learned in China. These believers in Jesus, they realize one thing. I am on this earth and I am a follower of Jesus because it is my job to go out and fulfill the Great Commission. Go and tell people about Jesus. When you and I forget why we're called and what we are here for, we'll get into sin.
And we'll start thinking, poor me, I need to have the affair because my husband's not very nice to me. Poor me, I don't have any money, so I'm going to steal. Everything starts becoming about us. It's got to stop. It has to be all about him. If you are a follower of Jesus, your life is not your own anymore. And when we do stupid things like David just did, he destroyed his life for the rest of his life. And I wonder how many people did not follow God because of how David acted. Stay focused. 1 Corinthians 9:23 says, I do all things for the sake of the gospel. He does not say, I just do anything I want and live my own life. He says, I do every single thing in my life to promote the gospel of Jesus so that I may become a fellow partaker of it. Do you not know those who run in a race all run, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may win. We have got to realize what it means to be a follower of Jesus, and we have to run that race so that other people can know him and spend eternity in heaven. I wonder if I could interview David right here and say, David, was it worth it? I bet you anything he would say, absolutely not. And I think that he would beg us to stop and think before we do anything that goes against what God has commanded us not to do. Father, thank you so much for your word and for this life of David. It's so overwhelming to see that somebody who loves you so much can fall so hard. God, I pray for each person here and each person listening to us that that will not happen to us. I pray, God, that we will get our focus on you and you alone, and we will stop thinking about everything in the world that we think we need or we're unhappy, but God, help us to focus on you and the Great Commission and telling people about you. I pray that for every person in here, bless these women, God. Help us to run the race that is set in front of us. Do not let sin hinder us from what you have called us to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Just to say, God, I'm adding you into my equation. I'm adding you into this problem. And when God had a purpose for his pit, just like he has a purpose for your pit that you're into, he's not going to let you down. When you believe the Bible and the Bible alone, I said, that's what we... Suddenly one day you're going to wake up and you're going to be like, I don't really have animosity towards that person anymore. But I promise you that I think today you'll be really, really encouraged at the very end because I learned something I never even thought of.